I'm really happy to have Gea-Ny Tseng today here. She came to us all the way from Richmond, Virginia. And Gea-Ny actually did her undergraduate work in Taiwan, the National University of Taiwan, and then came to Columbia University in New York for her Ph.D. in pharmacology at the time that Brian Hoffman was chairing the department. And then she had a, I don't know how long of a duration, but some time in Japan with Aki Noma. I know that was 2 months with Aki. And then came back to Columbia for a postdoctoral position. And from there, went to Richmond, Virginia, where she's now a professor in physiology and biophysics. And Gea-Ny had done some really beautiful work on structure, function of ion channels, in particular potassium channels, and within that family of channels on IKS. So that's what she will tell us today. Thanks for coming.
I would like to thank Dr. Lee for the invitation and a kind introduction. I would like to thank people who have spent time with me today to talk about your research. It's been intellectually very stimulating and totally enjoyable. And I would like to thank you all for coming at this time of the day. I hope you all have a fruitful, a productive day today, and I hope my presentation will add to your day. Can you all hear me well?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So I will be talking about cardiac slow delayed rectifier, or IKS channel. This little video that should be moving but is not is an imaginary structure of the IKS channel produced by Sander in 2008. And here, this is a simulation of impulse generation and production in a beating heart. I would like to use this to make 3 points. First, despite years of work by many people, many outstanding questions remain in understanding how the IKS channel functions. Second, IKS distribution and function in the heart is really important for the normal propagation of impulses in the heart. And third, concerted efforts are needed to make the link between the atomic structure of the channel to the functioning of the heart. With that, I will pay homage to my host here. Dr. Rudy and his collaborators here are really making the pioneering effort to try to make a link between the two worlds. So here is the outline of my presentation. I will spend very brief moments to give you an introduction, and then finally with the conclusion. I will spend most of my time talking about 3 aspects of research in my group. I would like to spend 15 to 20 minutes each for the first and the second one, and perhaps 5 minutes for the third one. I know you have a habit of asking questions in the middle of the discussion, and that I think is very good. So I will keep the time, and if I feel that I need to move forward, I will skip some slides. And hopefully, the arrangement of the slides is such that you will get the main points that I want to convey to you. So the one slide I cannot skip is the slide showing you the small group of people that I've been working with. Some of them have been working with me, for example, Ming Chen, since 1995, so we have been through a lot. It's really great to work with these nice people. So cardiac slow IKS channel has 2 components. For booming KCNQ, one or KV7.1, or an auxiliary KCNQ1, or also called Ming K. I will call them Q1 and the E1 in the following slides. So Q1 is a typical voltage-gated potassium channel with 4 subunits coming together to form a functional channel. Each subunit has 6 transmitter segments. S1 to S4 form the voltage sensor in the periphery of the channel. S5, P-loop, and S6 coming together from 4 subunits forming the pore conducting portion. KCNQ1 is a small protein, has 1 transmitter domain, N-terminal and C-terminal on 2 sides of the membrane. The relationship between Q1 and E1 was recognized by 2 groups in 1996, published in Nature simultaneously. When you put Q1 in the cell or in an oocyte, you get a typical voltage-gated channel like many other delayed rectifier channels. When you put E1 in mammalian cells, although not in oocytes, you get no current. You put them together, you form a very nice, slowly activating voltage-gated potassium channel, which is very similar to the IKS channel one can recall from a guinea pig ventricular mouse. And I'm proud to tell you that this is the first of A cells I recorded on January 28th this year. when you compare the current trace of IKS with the action potential from the same cell, you see that the IKS activates slowly. And during one action potential with a duration of about 400 milliseconds, you have a very limited amount of activation. I think this is, as you mentioned, that this is really exaggerated. I was using a holding of minus 40 millivolt. I set to very positive voltages. So the activation will be otherwise much slower if I begin with a resonant potential. In this case, I was trying to inactivate many other channels to get the current, isolated current. Because of the slow rate of activation, IKS does not play a major role in repolarizing action potentials in human ventricular myocytes under normal conditions or basal conditions. And therefore, this is very nice work published by Bowers group in 2005, showing action potentials recorded from human papillary muscle under basal conditions or under stress. So under basal conditions, nothing major happened. Blocking the IKS with HMR156 will not give you much change in action potential duration. However, if you block the IKR with dofaculite, and then you stimulate a beta adrenergic receptor with adrenaline, you will have, then you put on HMR156, you now begin to see a prolongation of action potential duration, reflecting the fact that under these stressful conditions, IKS is making a contribution to action potential repolarization, and therefore blocking with the drug can give you prolongation of APD. And therefore, loss of function in genes encoding IKS components will give you long QT 1 or long QT 5. On the other hand, gain of function mutations increasing Q1 have been linked to short QT syndrome or familial atrial fibrillation. And here I just want to raise this question. I don't think we know whether IKS is really necessary for action potential repolarization in human atria. On the other hand, IKS may actually be a liability factor for atrial fibrillation in the human atria under some conditions. Let me begin my presentation of working my lab by telling you something we have done with native IKS in cardiac myocytes. We studied the distribution and remodeling of IKS in the heart. And I want to really emphasize 2 points during this presentation. That is, the partnership between Q1 and E1 can be quite dynamic. And second, other KCNA subunits may play a role in native IKS channel function. So IKS distribution in the heart is not homogeneous. Here are 3 gradients of IKS observed in the heart. And these are necessary working with other channels to ensure that the impulse can be propagated in a normal fashion throughout the heart. The mechanisms for this IKS heterogeneity can be due to differences in Q1 and or E1 protein expression level. However, the microRNA now have been recognized to be an important regulator of protein expression, and therefore making the link between messenger RNA and protein is more complicated. Bimita in my lab showed that IKS shows a 4th gradient in the heart, at least in guinea pig heart, that is in the atria, IKS current density is much higher than in the ventricular myocyte. These are both from the left side of the heart. When we look at the protein expression, probing the proteins from different regions, left and right atrial septum, left and right ventricles of guinea pig heart, we see that the Q1 protein is modestly expressed at higher level in the atria than in the ventricles. P competing, one does not show any significant difference among the five regions. This lipid gradient of Q1 perhaps will contribute to ITS gradient higher in atria, low in the ventricle. When we look at the protein expression in these myocytes, we were surprised by what we found. Here we're using Q1 shown as green fluorescence to show its distribution in atria of ventricular myocytes from guinea pig heart. We were able to use excessive antigen to block the antibody and abolish or greatly reduce the fluorescence. This does not really tell us whether this is a real protein or not, but this is the test we have done. So in the atria, Q1 is highly localized on the cell surface, especially in the interface between cells, which is also the case for KCD1 shown in this purple fluorescence column. On the other hand, for the Q1 protein in the ventricular myocytes, it shows this continuous sparse staining on the peripheral cell surface, but very strong staining in the striation pattern in the cytoplasm, which is different from the KCD1 distribution in ventricular myocytes. And therefore, the degree of Q1E1 co-localization in myocytes varies, higher in atria, lower in the ventricle. And this can contribute to the ITS gradient in guinea pig. And these differences in co-localization also plays a role in ITS remodeling that we have studied in the model of spontaneously hypertensive rats, or SHR. When these rats reach an age of 18 to 22 months old, they have very severe hypertrophy. They have signs of a heart failure, and they have very often enlarged and thrombotic left atria, suggesting that they have half atrial fibrillation, and they have very severe interstitial fibrosis and other signs of pathology. And they show IPO downregulation in the heart, as one would expect from general finding of electric remodeling in a diseased heart. But when we try to look at the IKS as an HMR-1556 sensitive current, we were surprised to see that the IKS is actually larger in the old SHR ventricular myocytes from very sick hypertrophy and sometimes bleeding heart. Heart shows signs of heart failure. When we look at the protein expression from, in this example, four young and four old SHR hearts, we see that the Q1 protein level is not really reduced, increased. The KCD1 40 kilodalton band actually shows a decrease, and the degree of reduction seems to be correlated with the degree of heart failure or hypertrophy of the heart. And Kumasi blue span shows that the loading was even. And therefore, the protein expression level cannot explain why IPS is increased in old SHR mouses. Again, we look at the protein expression using immunofluorescence and confocal microscopy. And you see that in young SHR left ventricular myocytes, Q1 again shows this very nice striation pattern of distribution. And KCD1 shows cell surface distribution. However, when we look at the old SHR myocytes, we see that Q1 now is redistributed to the cell peripheral surface along with E1. So when we use the pseudo color to show the region of the myocyte where the two signals overlap with each other, the degree of overlapping between Q1E1 is much higher in old SHR myocytes than in the young SHR myocytes. Therefore, we suggest that the increased degree of co-localization between Q1 and E1 can contribute to the increase of ITS in old SHR myocytes.
Question?
Yes.
Do you have any information on the T2-mule geometry between young and old?
In the SHR model, the T2-mule is in this array. When they reach the old state, old age. So that could be coincidence, or that could be a mechanism for why the Q1 redistribute to the peripheral cell surface. Yes.
Did you look at the current properties between the old and the young and see if all are you looking through to show them?
with the drug separation, what we can say is that HMR sensitive current shows very similar kinetics of activation, deactivation, and voltage dependence of activation between young and old. So you will expect that with E1, high E1 colocalization, there will maybe a positive shift in activation curve. On the other hand, it can be the case that with this Q1 in the inside the cell, that those Q1 may not be functional or maybe it's kinetically silent because they have such small conductors. So this brings me to the question, if Q1 is not always associated with E1 in cardiomyocytes, can you find other partners? And we know that there is a family of KCNE subunits, chrome. A lot of them cloned by Abbott when working with Goldstein, published in 1999. They call this MINK related peptide, peptides 1 to 3, or we call them KCNE 2, KCNE 4, and KCNE 5 or MERT 4 was cloned subsequently. They are all small proteins with one transmembrane domain, and the sequence homology is pretty high in the transmembrane region. And in the region immediately following the transmembrane domain. What's relevant for our discussion here is that all the new members of KCNE family can associate with Q1 and confer a distinct channel phenotype. So E2 and E4 will reduce or abolish the current. E2 and E3 will make the Q1 channel almost largely pun-independent. So my lab has spent about 10 years studying KCNE2 in various contexts, and this is where I'm going to focus for my following discussion. Our interest in KCNE2 stems from the observation that E2 mutations have been linked to long QT6 or atrial fibrillation. We have used two antibodies to show that KCNE2 protein can be detected in human ventricles. And following that, we have shown that KCNE2 is co-localized with KCNQ1 in ventricular myocytes. In Cos7 expression system, we can co-IP E1 with E2 in the presence of Q1, but not in its absence, and therefore suggesting that Q1, E1, and E2 form ternary complex. Functionally, what kind of change do we have? Here we're comparing Cos7 expression expressing Q1 alone, Q1 plus E1, Q1 plus E2, or Q1 plus both E1 and E2. We maintain the CDNA among the same. Q1 in this case, and in this case, adding more KCNE2. And we see that with KCNE2 co-expression, the slow activation kinetics is the same as in the absence of KCNE2, just Q1 and E1. But the current amplitude is dramatically reduced. We use confocal experiment to show that in 80% of the myocytes, of the Cos7 cells, positive for KCNQ1, they also express both E2 and E1, indicating that although we are doing transient transfection, we can get all three proteins into one cell, and we can use the patch cam data to infer the relationship among the three. And therefore, we suggest that, but we can also show this in adult cardiac myocytes. In this case, we are using guinea pig ventricular myocytes because of the very robust IKS current that we can recall from all myocytes. And we use adenovirus to infect the cells with transfer the gene encoding KCNE2 with an HA epitope to these myocytes, and use confocal to look at the distribution of these proteins. The exogenous E2 recognized by the epitope and the native Q1 in these myocytes. And you can see that the E2 also show striation pattern of distribution overlapping with that of native Q1. And when we count the immunofluorescence intensity, we actually saw a slight increase in Q1 immunofluorescence in this adenovirus E2 infected cells. However, when we look at the currents, we see that compared with control myocytes that have been cultured under the same conditions for the same amount of time, infection with adenovirus E2 reduced the time-dependent current due to depolarization and the tail current upon repolarization. After culturing for several days in the serum-free medium, the PVP myocytes showed this very strange time-independent current component and actually a tracing all current-like component. We don't know what they are, but they don't show statistical significant difference between these two conditions. And with E2 expression, we reduce the current but does not change the voltage dependence of activation. Yes.
So those are really transient currents. That's not capacity transient, and you're missing the activation.
No,
phase.
This is a 2 second. In this case, perhaps 4 second pulse. This is two. It's not capacity transient, and we can use voltage to inactivate this channel. It could be a chloride channel because we can block. Let me just stop there. It could be a chloride channel.
Curious, when you have E1 and E2 with Q1, let's assume there are two beta subunits for each channel. So that you should have, when you have this mixture, you should have some of Q1 plus E2 along the channel. That's pure Q1 and E2 without the E1.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, you expect to see some instantaneous current at the beginning of the pulse, but I don't see that.
No, we did not see that.
Yeah, so how do you explain that result?
One possibility is that in most of the Q1 channel in the cell, they are associated with both E1 and E2. And the gating, I see how you put it. I'm sorry for being not complete. When a Q1 is associated with multiple KCNE subunits, the functional consequence is not the equivalent of A plus B or E1 plus E2. There's a hierarchy.
That is understandable. But what I'm asking is that there should be a case that you only have the E2 and the Q1, right? So just by, binomial distribution, you have actually quite sizable Q1 plus E2. But why don't you see the incidence?
This is the observation.
Yeah,
I can only show you about the data.
Are you suggesting that it's a random association of Q1 and E1? Or Q1 and E2?
Yeah, Q1 and E2.
But it may not be, right?
The
idea is it may be directed, it may be forced stoichiometry.
Or maybe you require E1 before you can bind E2.
Yeah, within the cell it could be a forced stoichiometry, right?
Because your assumption is based on random.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not.
Then what it could be other than random?
I don't know, but the fact that she doesn't see it might suggest.
Do you have any hypothesis? What could be the random?
We can come to that.
Interesting.
So what I would like to suggest is that in cardiac myocytes, what we see as IKS or as component or composing of Q1 and E1 may actually have an E2 component, but because the E2 presence is silent kinetically, it may escape the detection by patch clean experiment. Now, I want to spend, in the interest of time, I will skip some of the slides, but the next part of the presentation is to show some results suggesting that the partnership between Q1 and E1 or E2 in cells can be quite dynamic. And therefore, when you have this situation, the relationship between Q1 and E1 or E2 will be determined not only by the level and temporal relationship of transcription and translation, but will be also influenced by the binding affinity and trafficking pattern of these myocytes, these sublimated cells. So let me skip these two. I just come to this data. Here I'm showing you what the previous few slides will show that E1 can dissociate from Q1, and E1 needs help from Q1 to traffic to the cell surface, whereas E2 can traffic to the cell surface independently. For the third part of the experiment, I want to show some data suggesting that E2 can associate with Q1 with vacancy in the cell membrane, meaning that you don't have to have Q1 E1 or Q1 E2 form during translation. You can have them separately on the cell surface, but they can find each other and form a channel. Yes?
Is there a way to quantitatively measure the expression of E1, E2, and Q1 in the cell?
By Western blot?
Has it been done?
In what condition?
In your experiments?
Would this be useful?
So then it would be a probability problem. If you have 50% of E2 and 100% of Q1, then there's going to be a higher probability of Q4.
I think it's not a straightforward thing to try to compare two proteins in their expression in the cell, because you are using two different antibodies, and the antibodies can have different binding affinity and whatnot. Easy to use one antibody to detect protein expression under different conditions from different cell types, but it's a totally different thing to try to compare two proteins expressed in the same cell environment using two different antibodies. I don't know whether that answers your question or not.
Because there's always been this question of E1 association with Q1 being a variable stoichiometry. So I was wondering if it was possible to measure the expression of E1 and Q1 and maybe derive from that what the possible stoichiometries could be.
I think more sophisticated methods will have to be used to address that question. I'll just rest the plot. So in this experiment, we used the approach described, I'm sorry, you cannot read this very well, published in 1995, by expressing E1 also, E1 or E2 in COR7 cells, and make vesicles from these cells, inject the vesicles into oocytes and see what happens to the channel. And if we inject E1 vesicles into control oocytes that did not receive any CRNA injection, we will begin with oocytes showing very small current on the basal conditions. 8 to 22 hours after E1 vesicle injection, we see this very nice slow IPS-like current, indicating that the E1 can be delivered through the vesicles to the cell membrane, finding the native Q1 channel in the oocyte membrane associated with it. And if we inject E1 vesicles into oocytes that have been injected with Q1 cRNA, we can see that the E1 vesicle will induce, and this is a control oocyte, this is E1 vesicle injected oocyte, you will have a slow phase of activation, slow phase of deactivation, reflecting the portion of Q1 channels that have incorporated E1 from the vesicles. Whereas injecting empty vesicles will not give you any change. Yes?
Sorry, was there a purification step that meant you knew it was peptide being delivered and not DNA?
This is vesicles and no nuclei from the cell formation. So,
I have a similar question. Why do you think that it needs 22 hours before you see the association?
Well, I don't know how easy it is for the protein to be incorporated into the cell membrane. I actually don't know for sure whether it is vesicle delivered protein to the cell surface membrane or through the intracellular compartments, vesicular compartments, and then it will travel to the cell membrane. The shortest time we measured was actually doing the semi tech of PCM2. We waited for 3 hours and we could detect semi tech from the cell membrane. So to answer your question, we waited for 8 hours because we did not know how long we should have been waiting. And we, if we waited for 3-4 hours, we probably will get the same results. So in this case, we deliver E2 with a CBAC tag in the extracellular domain to 006. Wait for 3 hours using HA antibody and immunoluminescence to detect cell surface CBAC tag in the intact 006 and indeed we can detect some of the 006 expressing CBAC on the cell surface. And with E2 injection to oocytes that have been injected with Q1C RNA, we saw a reduction in the current consistent with the phenotype that we saw with Ca2-C RNA injection. So so coming together, this series of experiments published in 2008 suggests that the relationship between Q1 and different casein subunits can be quite dynamic. And E2 can serve as a dynamic silent IKS suppressor. And the experiments in progress in the lab is to determine how Q1 and different casein subunits, how their distribution patterns are determined in myocytes, and what will be the mechanism of Q1 redistribution to the cell surface in both SHR myocytes. So with that, I will proceed to the second part of my presentation.
Can I ask you a question before you do? So can you tag these proteins with other than MYC, like could you put GFP or YFP?
Yes.
Because you could, if you could do your experiment optically,
uh-huh,
in like measured FRET, it
uh-huh
would, you might,
yeah,
have you
yeah
tried that?
Yeah, we have these red tagged E1 and E2 and GFP tagged Q1, and we have them.
Because you'd be able to get at the Jean Min's question of what's the time course of this exchange, and it might be
right.
This previous experiment where you're delivering in the vesicles,
mm-hmm,
so what if you, can you, there's supposed to be this dynamic relationship where the E1 can join the channel, or the E2, depending on which you deliver. So can you compete that effect off? So let's say you express a very high level of E1, and then do you not see the effect of E2 in vesicles?
I haven't done those experiments, but I will have something I will show you that E2, that type of competition experiment in the third part of my presentation.
Virginia, I have one thing that I don't understand. So you showed that the E1 alone does not express to the surface membrane. So where is your vesicle of EU1 prepared from?
From COS7 cells.
And in those cells, the E1 can...
The vesicles perhaps is a mix of intracellular compartment and cell surface compartment. When we prepare vesicles, we simply run out the cells and make vesicles. And they are not destroyed. We are not separating the cell surface membrane.
I see. So then what you see does not necessarily mean that the E1 and the Q1 are actually see each other at the surface membrane and going together. The association could happen in the ER or
inside the cell,
even after the
vesicle injection. We haven't done experiments to determine where exactly the association happens. But
in the ER though, unless it's newly made protein, it would have to be recycled from the cell surface in some endosome.
Right. I should say intracellular organelles,
yeah,
and vesicles.
Yeah.
Right.
But we don't know if you get all the mature protein anyway. Yeah. So in another question is related that the experiment by Hirokobo Hirokobo from Japan,
uh-huh,
and also Isopod.
Uh-huh.
So they had the paper in PNAS about the stoichiometry,
right,
of the channels, and they actually labeled fluorescence labeled
mm-hmm
E1 and Q1, and in their
in their label, in their image, there are particles that are that seem to be just E1 alone. And
mm-hmm.
also they commented that the E1 could actually make to the surface membrane
mm-hmm.
just by itself.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a comparative trend. When we put E1 in causative cells and use bioaccumulation to look at the cell surface protein, use actin to show that what the loading is 1 to 10. So it may seem that we have a lot of actin in the bioaccumulation fashion, but it's actually much more dramatic. Well, it's just not a true because we have loading. We do have some E1 on the cell surface. It's not that it does not reach the cell surface totally.
Which band is E1, I'm sorry?
E1 alone.
The band. Which
mm-hmm.
Oh, this is actually E1 band.
Yeah, right.
I
this
see.
Is different degrees of glycosylation give you several bands in E1. So let me then begin with the second part of my presentation, structure function relationship of Q1 and E1. I hope it's not too. This is our starting point. We have the crystal structures of KV channels that can serve as templates for homology modeling. We have case in E1 and our structure that we can use as our structure model. And it's a matter of docking the E1 to Q1 to create the Q1-E1 complex. The challenges here are twofold. First, we need to model the crystal structures are the open or activated inactivated states. So how to go from the open state to the closed state is a very important question. And also, the casein U1 ML structure was solved in a detergent micelle. The detergent micelle is such an environment that it will create non-native bending of the casein U1 structure, and you cannot directly use the structure for docking. So our strategy is the following. We will dock the transmembrane helix of E1 to Q1, then we will dock just the membrane region from outside and inside. Then we will dock remote helices of E1 to the Q1-E1 complex, and finally, if we feel we have to, we'll dock the remote loop. And along the course of this experiment, we use spatial restraints based on the experiments. Now, this is a work in progress. We are not there yet. I want to show you what we have done, how we do our experiments, how we interpret our results, and some new results that came out just a few weeks ago that are quite interesting. So our approach is disulfide tracking. We create cysteine-free Q1-E1 background. We then reintroduce cysteine into different positions. We check the function of this Q1-E1 cysteine double mutants to make sure that we are only studying channel complexes that behave like the wild-type channel. Therefore, the conformation can be used to refer back to the native channel. And then we can use MTS reagent to test accessibility of different cysteine sections, the state dependence, or the reaction rates. But most importantly, we want to see where we can find disulfide bond formation partners in these Q1-E1 complexes. And with that, we can study the state dependence of disulfide bond formation and the rate of disulfide bond formation. Of course, the advantages of this approach is that we are studying functional channels in native membrane environment. We can really make a good link from the contact. You need to have the cysteine sections coming close to each other within 6 angstrom, at least transiently, to form disulfide bonds. So the contact information along with the state dependence of disulfide bond formation will be really helpful in creating models of Q1-E1 complex in different gating states. And I want to use one example published just recently to show how we do our experiments. In this case, we are interested in the very flexible loop in the extracellular region of casein V1. And we want to know how this loop is making contact with casein Q1 in a real channel in the cell membrane. And the target site for Q1 for now is 140 to 148 position of 148 S1, S2 linker. So this shows representative immuno block experiments pairing Q1 with cysteine at position 144 or Q1 147 with casein 1 wild type or with cysteine mutants at position 36 to 43. And this was done on the non-reducing conditions of this DTP treatment. We also, these are casein Q1 immunoblocks, and this is casein E1 immunoblock. With Q1 monomer, we have a cystic Q1 protein. With casein E1, we have a range of molecular sizes. And some of them are in the 20 kilodalton size. With some of the Q1 E1 pairs, we could see a very clear 80 kilodalton band. Sometimes also a 75 kilodalton band. And this band disappear after we treat the membrane with respect to protein with DDP. When we don't see any bands in some of the pairs, the casein E1 is expressed well. So the lack of the 80 kilodalton band, which we believe is a Q1 E1, doesn't have bonding form, is not due to the lack of the binding partner. So based on these results, we generate this following diagram, again published in 2011, just recently. Here I'm showing you seven panels, each from a Q1 cysteine substituted variants from position 140 to 148, pairing with casein E1 cysteine mutants from position 36 to 47. And we used the ratio of the 80 kilodalton band to 60 kilodalton band as a measure of the degree of basophile bond formation. And for those black bars, indicates that there are significant basophile bond formation. Again, this is reminding us that this is a region of interest here. So we have a region of active basophile bond formation between Q1 and E1. And two positions are excluded, 143 and 146. We cannot study them because in Western blood experiment, they show up as much smaller bands versus the white type or other cysteine mutant bands. And when we do oocyte expression, they have much smaller currents versus white type casein Q1. So perhaps they have a folding problem and they cannot reach the cell surface and instead being degraded inside the cell. And by the way, when we do patch kind experiment on the COR7 cells expressing these two mutants, we could not detect any current. And it's probably because, yes?
I'm noticing that the current amplitude, you cut it off at 0.4, which means that it's at least half the size of the wild type. And yet you see zero protein that's the full length. So I'm wondering, is it because they form internal disulfides or something that folds the protein up and it runs at it, it just runs at it?
Oh, I'm sorry, are you is talking about this slide or the previous slide?
I'm talking about this slide.
Okay.
I'm jumping on the top panel.
Uh-huh.
You see the protein running at 60 instead of 70.
Uh-huh.
So you would say it's truncated. Then I look at the right and I
uh-huh.
see that on the right hand top panel,
uh-huh.
where the y-axis, go to the right, the y-axis goes from 0.4 to 1, which
uh-huh.
means that the currents are 0.5 or 0.6, so there's pretty substantial currents.
Uh-huh. These
so
are oocyte expression and COR7 expression.
Yeah.
I think the temperature during COR7 expression at 36 will be very harsh on abnormally folded protein, and therefore the protein cannot reach the cell surface and patch clamp did not reveal any currents. On the other hand, in oocytes, they are cultured at 16 degrees Celsius. And
but you don't show the COR7 current?
Because we don't have current.
They couldn't measure any currents.
We cannot detect any current. The data are not included here. Yeah.
But I'm still wondering if it's really because of degradation, or is it possible that there's an internal disulfide that keeps it tight and it just runs faster on the gel?
Oh, okay. Yeah, you mean 143C may form disulfide bond with something else.
With itself or something else that keeps the protein globular and it just runs faster on SPS.
Would that be a 50 kilodalton protein double bands? I'm not sure.
It could make the protein just run that much faster.
We don't know the reason, but I think the bottom line here is that these two mutants, cysteine mutants, behave abnormally versus the other mutants, very different from the wild, and therefore we cannot use them for dasylide tracking experiment, which is our main focus here. And so we want to focus on this region between 144, 145, 147, and KCNE1 positions 36 to 43 in our following voltage climb experiments here down in oocyte expression system. I want to use my favorite example to illustrate this point. And here we have two oocytes expressing Q1 without native cysteine and with cysteine at position 145 and U1 at position 40. This is actually our first oocyte that we were able to detect this phenotype. So when we take the oocyte out from the incubator and put two electrodes in the cell, we got a very nice slow activating current. And we measure the initial pump independent current in this panel here, nothing here. We wash in DDT for 10 minutes. We have an increase in the current, but still the current is slow in activation. Then we wash out DDT for about 15 minutes, pulsing the oocyte from minus 100 to plus 60 for 2 seconds every once per minute. And we have this very dramatic build-up of time-independent current in this oocyte. Then this will suggest to us that something dramatic is happening. So we took another oocyte from the incubator, DSM, impairment, recording, slow current, DDT, increasing the current, still slow in activation. But during DDT washout, we hold the membrane at minus 100 millivolt, keep the channel in the closed state. And then we, after 15 minutes, we came back with a pulse. The first one shows a further increase in the current, as in this case, but very little time independent current. After that one pulse to plus 60 millivolt for 2 seconds, we came back with a second pulse. Then we have a full-blown time independent current. And that stayed very stable for the rest of the recording. So what we think is happening is that when oocytes were incubated in making proteins for us, that cysteine at position 145 or E1 position 40 is specified bounded with something else that we haven't been able to find yet. So it gives us this slow current, and then we add DTT to reduce dasylide bonds that frees up the cysteine side chains from whatever other partners they may have. But if we hold the cell at minus 100 millivolt, no chance for activation, then they don't come close to each other. They don't form dasylide bonds. When we depolarize the cell membrane to plus 60 millivolt for only 2 seconds, they come together, boom, they form dasylide bonds. And we can show the same using biochemistry. This is going back to COS7 expression. We have Q1-145C alone or with E140C. Without any treatment, we see this very nice 80 kilodalton band in the western block. If we treat the cells with DDT and then make whole cell lysine, we don't have that band. If after DDT treatment, we incubate the cells in 100 millimolar potassium for 5 minutes to depolarize the cell membrane to 0 millivolt and allows the channel to open, then we make our whole cell lysine and we can get that 80 kilodalton band. So this is biochemical data supporting the notion that the disulfide bonds between 145 and 40 forms in the open state of the channel. And I'm jumping a few slides now, and I took them all this morning. So this is a summary of probably 2 years of work. So we are pairing, this is the disulfide bond strength, or degree of disulfide bonds. Yellow, or red, very high, very low. and I'm linking the E1 and T1 positions with arrows of different colors reflecting the degree of the sapphire bonds and the thickness of the sapphire bond strength, and some of them happen in the resting state, some of them happen in the activated state. And I think what I learned from this project is that, well, before I began this project, my notion was that the sapphire bond can be formed when two positions are close to each other. And this is our spatial restraint. We can use that to make our docking model. But after finishing this project, I learned that proteins are very dynamic. It's the dynamics of protein conformational changes that explain the protein function. So it is not surprising then that one Q1 position can disaffect bounded with so many E1 positions, and vice versa. And how this data can help us in creating models of Q1 E1 complex. I would say when we do our MD simulations of Q1 E1 complex, we can look at the percentage of contacts between these different positions and select those structures where they show very frequent contacts. For example, between Q1 position 147 and E1 position 40. So this data will be useful, but it does not allow us to create static structure models because we cannot use that to explain transformation of the function. So, I think the timing is,
Just a quick question. So in your DTP experiments, so both subunits are cisless backbone, right?
Yes.
So are you suggesting that there is something else, other protein that actually is in play to form?
In some cases, yes, because we have the proteins are not in vacuum; they are in the sea of other proteins in the cell membrane or inside the cell, so they can form disaffect bonds with native proteins. But we just have not been able to find those partners yet. We tried them. I want to show you some very preliminary results as a collaboration with Nan Tui in my department, who is a computation person. He said, Ginny, let me try doing this. We will adjust the KCNE1 ML structure, yanking the loop away from the transmitter region so that it won't fall back to the membrane. So, and then he will do the MD simulations in the POPC lipids and dock the transmembrane to Q1 and apply filters to select the most the best model they can find, and then attach the N and C terminal domains to the KCNE1 transmembrane region, and then do MD simulations of the complex of Q1 and full-length E1 and analyze the Q1 E1 compact points. So in the beginning, I was quite skeptical about this approach, they went ahead and tried this anyway. And here is the MD trajectories of 100 nanoseconds of KCNE1 alone and the Q1 E1 complex, four Q1 and two E1 in the system. So with E1 alone, it shows a lot of motions and not very stable. But if you look at the transmembrane domain only, it shows a pretty stable correlation. And then with Q1 and E1 together, because Q1 is a large model crystal structure, the whole system is actually more stable. So we were analyzing this Q1 E1 complex in the equilibrium phase of the Q1 trajectory. And here is the surprise. I mean, when I saw this, I thought this is so nice. So here again, we begin with an MAR structure with non-native conformation, and here are seven representative snapshots of the KCNE1 full-length protein in the lipid bilayer in the MD trajectory, and you can see that the transmembrane region is quite stable, does not move a lot. But the extracellular and intracellular domains move a lot, and they are pretty dynamic. And so they dock the transmembrane region to the Q1 channel and they select the most convincing configuration, and we attach the actual surrounding interstitial domain and subject the whole system to MD simulation for another 1.2 nanosecond. And here is the analysis of the KC and V1 structure. So I'm showing you using color coding, the grid does not show the areas of E1 that does not make contact with Q1 during that MD trajectory. And I use the different colors to indicate infrequent contacts between E1 and Q1, or very frequent contacts between the two proteins. And you can see that in the extracellular region, the loop just outside the transmembrane region, where our experiments show that there are very frequent contacts between Q1 and E1, the system does give us a very high frequency of contacts between Q1 and E1. And this is a region of the very N-terminus region that also shows very frequent contact. The physiological function of that is not known. We will do experiments to map the contact points. And in the intracellular region, right following the transmembrane region, there are also contact points between E1 and Q1 is split over. So, I think it's kind of surprising that in the transmembrane region, the analysis reveals only three contact points between E1 and Q1, which is tyrosine 46, isoleucine 61, and flip over tyrosine 58. And so in the past, Al George's work suggests that KCNE1 really use the transmembrane region to associate with Q1. And here, we would expect to see a lot of contact, but we did not. Now, when we compare this data to our system scan immunogenesis, we found a correlation. And this is these are results from OSA expression of Q1 along with even white type or different system mutants. The point here is that among all these mutants, let me just go to the next slide. If we use the V1 half of activation as the parameter to gauge the degree of perturbation, tyrosine 46C, isoleucine 61C, and threonine 58C are the three positions that show perturbation of Q1E1 gating. And we compare that to the KCNE2 system scan that we published a few years ago, and the patterns look very different. And so the context between E2 and Q1 are different. And E2 is something else we are working on. And if we look at the channel conductance, the conductance property using rubidium to potassium conductance ratio as a parameter, we see again that tyrosine 46C and isoleucine 61C are the two positions where system substitution perturb the channel conductance properties, conduction properties. So, what's our in process in the lab is to use this as our rough as our beginning point to identify novel Q1E1 contact points in the channel. So I think the timing is quite good. I will use the following 3 minutes or so to talk about the third topic, which is IPS therapeutics. We are interested in knowing whether we can find a way to disrupt E2 modulation of Q1, of Q1 plus E1, to increase the IPS current amplitude. And the question then is, how do you design, we want to use a peptide approach. How do you design the peptide? And here is how we do it. We compare KCNE1 and KCNE2 in the sequence alignment, and we divide the proteins into five regions, A, B, C, D, and E. This is the transmembrane region, and this is the immediate following region with high degree of sequence homology. And we start to do truncation and deletion to see how which regions are dispensable in KCNE1 or KCNE2 function, of which are not dispensable. And what we found, let me very quickly just come here. We found that the N region of KCNE1 here we have hitting Q1 expressed alone with Y-type E2 or with different deletion truncation mutations of E2. And this is the current amplitude, and this is so-called constitutive components of the complex. So with alone, you have large current and very small independent current component. With E2 Y-type, you reduce the current, but increase the time-independent current component. And by chopping any of the regions on KCE2, we can now retain the KCE2 modulation of Q1. Similarly, we can disrupt KCE2 modulation of another panel, KD4.2. However, if we just chop the end, the C-terminal end of KCE2 from amino acid 98 to 123, we can retain KCE2 modulation of KD4.2, but not KCE1. And this is what we need. We need to only disrupt E2 modulation of Q1, but not other E2 partners. We don't want to too dramatically influence the electrical activity. And so we synthesize peptides, the E2 C-terminal peptide, or the scramble peptides. And some of the peptides are just bare peptides that we need to inject into myocytes or oocytes or put in the pipette solution for them to work. The others were conjugated with a PET a peptide to make them cell membrane permeable, and we can use control to show that indeed these peptides can get into the cells. But they like to go to the nuclei, and that's a problem. We have to design our peptide in a way that we don't require PET to make them cell membrane permeable. And here is a very preliminary summary of our results. We compare Q1 E1 co-expression, Q1 E2 co-expression, or KD4.3 expression in oocytes under control conditions, or incubated with scramble peptides, or after injection or intubation with the C-terminal peptides. And the most significant considered finding is that with Q1 E2 co-expression, that C2 C-terminal peptide can increase the current versus control or versus scramble peptide, suggest that we can disrupt E2 binding to Q1 by that small peptide from the C-terminus. And we are going to proceed to design smaller peptide to see whether we can retain effects, but use other methods to make the peptide cell more permeable. And I guess, I think one can imagine conditions where using such a peptide to relieve E2 suppression of Q1 could be useful. So with that, and I will conclude that IKS channel subunit composition in the heart may be more dynamic than previously realized. That is, Q1, E1, and also E2 will participate in IKS channel function. Second, structure basis of Q1 modulation. I'm not sure why I put that word here. I think it's possible, but more work needs to be done. And peptide drug is possible, but more needs to be done, I guess. Thank you for listening.
So the C-terminal region of the peptide that is having the effect, is that the region that has all the interaction in your... dog bone?
We haven't done the... I haven't show you the E2 MAR structure and MD simulation. The structure, the MAR structure for now, were all published by Sanders, and we use the...
No, but sorry, when you went back and did your probing...
Yeah.
Go back another couple of slides, and I'll say when. There. The gray, you probed every residue, right?
Uh-huh.
In the model, and most of it doesn't touch anything. So the bit of E2, the equivalent bit of E2, oh, that's E1.
That's E1, right.
But the equivalent bit of E2 would be that piece that is actually interacting? Is that the
system? E2 ML structure, we got the preliminary structure, actually look quite different from E1. It's a lot more rigid than E1. E1 has all this loop to make it...
Okay, but so Which is the C-terminus? The intracellular or
yes,
the extracellular?
Yes.
I can't remember.
This is the intracellular C-terminal domain.
So that's the bit that you're making your peptide that is having its effect in E2, right?
I'm making a peptide from the E2 sequence.
Yes.
That will be corresponding to this sequence in E1.
Okay.
In E1, if we chop off that sequence, we will not influence the E2 function as a Q1 modulator, which is consistent with lack of contacts in this region.
Okay.
On the other hand, for KCNE2, we chop that region, we abolish the E2 modulation of Q1. And the MLR structure is, this is taken from the unpublished MLR structure of E2. And you can see that in that region, it is still quite a portion of helical structure.
Okay.
So it is probably not the same as the E2 C-terminus.
A lot of the KCNA peptides differ a lot in the length of their C-terminus. So this portion that's important for E2, what is the corresponding section in E1?
Will be probably 94 to 120. Well, since the sequence is not homologous, the length differs. I think it's different. This is the really at the end of the KCNA2 sequence.
And E2 is it's shorter. Right?
123 on the IC. I did not use the last protocol. Yes.
So E1 touches Q1. Your simulation, we missed it. Do you know where it touches?
Yes. We have a big table listing where these different casing side chains are contacting Q1, and some of them are overlapping residues. But because there are so many points, I cannot memorize or show you the data. But some of them make a lot of sense. For example, the isoleucine 61 that show very dramatic gating effects is making quite frequent contacts with S1, S2 linker in the Q1. And the tyrosine 46 is making contact with the pore domain of Q1. And that also makes sense to us because the conductance is altered by that cis mutation.
Didn't the Bernard Tabby actually show some interaction in the C terminus?
Right, yes. He proposed that, and they should use FRAP to show that KCNE1 C-terminus and KCNQ1 C-terminus interact with each other. But I don't, maybe he has new data now, but he did not, at least I did not see any published results identifying the regions of E1 and Q1 that interact with each other.
I almost hate to ask this, but there's three more KCNE subunits. So do you think that they're all doing the same kind of thing? Or I mean, do you think that they're all involved in regulating KCNQ1 encoded channels and that they're doing this dance at the membrane?
I don't know. We haven't used antivirus to probe this issue. So I cannot answer that question. But it is not impossible when you have been in the cell. But I think that for modeling, this is it's really complicated in a cell, the movement of different channels, association, and whatnot. And here we are talking about KCNE2, maybe part of IKS in myocytes. But KCNE2 can also modulate HERG channel, KD4.3. HCN channel and perhaps KD1.5. So, how do the other alpha subunits compete with Q1 for bind to E1? We don't know. Ideally, we want to co-IP Q1 with different KCNE subunits from myocytes, and we tried for a long, long time. Could not co-IP even Q1 with E1 from guinea pig ventral myocytes. And you can, that should be the golden, the best source of Q1 E1 complex formation, guinea pig, very robust IKS curve.
Okay.
but we could not co-IP E1 with Q1. I don't know why. But maybe we don't have good enough antibody to do this.
Did you ever try to sort of covalently link them in the cells and then IP?
No, not yet. Maybe that should be some, that we should try that.
Yes. In one slide, you show the IKS current, remodeling happening, etc., right?
Mm-hmm.
So, what do you think about, is there some meaning suggest IKS current have some role in the hypertension?
Hypertension or hypertrophy? Hypertrophy in response to hypertension. Gene showed that in the hypertrophy mouse model, the E1 and Q1 messenger RNA are both upregulated. That's in the bomb. Yeah, right. So, and I took out one slide because I have too many already. In many disease, animal disease models, IKS is downregulated. Myocardial function, subacute, coronary wasp, and some other models. But when we look at the human heart, in many disease, atrial fibrillation, or cardiomyopathy, idiopathic cardiomyopathy, or heart failure, KCNE1 messenger RNA is increased. And in one case, KCNQ1 messenger RNA is also increased. So I think it is still a possibility that IKS may not always show downregulation in diseased heart. On the contrary, may show an increase as a rescue attempt to try to overcome the downregulation of IKO1, some other things.
I have a question. I wonder what's the distance do you give when you show the contact region in the E1 interacting with the Q1, and like what's the distance you define the contact region?
I think we use 7 or 9 angstrom. The student used both angstrom, both distances. I don't remember which data set I used. It's in the range of 7 to 9 angstrom between beta X, beta C X.
But for the cysteine, those cysteine mutation experiment, like the C distance for the effective cysteine bridge is about 6 angstrom, right? So it's already larger than that. I didn't remember clearly the later experiment you show you mutate the cysteine along the E1.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder like if the effect of the cysteine bridge will like give some artificial results, like to give you some like.
The cysteine scan along the transmembrane region was not done for disulfide therapy. We just use cysteine substitution to see the perturbation pattern. But actually, for your information, we try to detect disulfide bond formation between T58C
mm-hmm.
with its potential partners 338, 339, and 340C. We cannot see any disulfide bond formation. I think I mentioned this earlier today. A lot of the landmark contacts that, for example, Sanders used to create his Q1 E1 docking model, we could not find disulfide bond formation between those potential contact points.
Mm-hmm.
So, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Any other questions?
You mentioned there is an NMR structure of PCNE2. Uh-huh. Has it been published yet?
No. This is a collaboration with somebody in China. We hope to get it published soon.
Okay, well, thank you very much again.